My economic team is developing historic tax reform.
From the White House to Capitol Hill, Republicans are determined to lower the 35% corporate tax rate, the highest of any developed economy. But the tax code is filled with provisions that allow companies to pay less. Matt Gardner is a senior fellow with the Institute on Taxation and Economic Policy, a liberal Washington-based think tank.
The biggest, most profitable corporations are now finding it almost routine to escape paying the 35% tax. In some cases, they're easily finding ways to avoid paying any income tax at all.
That's because even though the U.S. taxes income earned anywhere in the world, the tax code allows American companies to defer paying taxes on income earned by their foreign subsidiaries indefinitely, as long as the profits are not returned to the parent company in the U.S. Here's a simple example. An American company that earns $1 billion in profits on sales in the United States would face a U.S. tax bill of $350 million before deductions, credits, and write-offs. But if the company records those profits to an overseas subsidiary in, say, Ireland, where the corporate tax rate is only 12.5%, it would owe the Irish government $125 million before any adjustments and nothing to the U.S. Treasury as long as the money is not brought home. Gardner's sister organization, Citizens for Tax Justice, estimates the deferral has enabled U.S. corporations to amass at least $2.6 trillion overseas.
When a major corporation basically shifts a lot of its profits overseas, how then do ordinary Americans end up footing the bill?
The most direct way is through large-scale spending cuts. Less direct spending on all the things that make the United States a good place to live. Healthcare, transportation, education, all the public services that we find most vital.
One legal maneuver companies use to minimize their U.S. tax bill is to sell or license intangible assets like software or drug patents to a lower tax foreign subsidiary. When a product made with that intellectual property is sold, the foreign subsidiary records the income, and because of that, U.S. taxes can be deferred.
We counted 10,000 tax haven subsidiaries among Fortune 500 corporations. Deferral creates a clear incentive for companies to shift their activities offshore, but more damagingly, it creates a clear incentive for them to pretend they're shifting their activities offshore.
Pretending to shift activities offshore is also the main critique of another legal tactic known as an inversion. That's when an American company changes its corporate citizenship by acquiring a firm based in a lower tax country or jurisdiction. Since the 1980s, more than 50 American companies have pulled this off, with 25 such deals in the past 5 years alone. Samsonite, the century-old luggage maker, moved its tax address from Massachusetts to Luxembourg, where the corporate tax rate is 19%. Restaurant Brands International, parent of fast food chain Burger King, relocated its headquarters from Florida to Canada, where the corporate tax rate is 15%. But the number one destination for tax inversions is Ireland, where at 12.5%, the corporate tax rate is nearly two-thirds lower than the U.S. The biggest company to change its tax address from the United States to Ireland is medical device maker Medtronic, which still maintains a hefty presence in its native Minnesota.
Medtronic's operational headquarters and all of its top executives are based in the United States, but its official headquarters is here in Dublin, Ireland, in that building behind me. That change of address was engineered 2 years ago when Medtronic bought Covidien, an Irish-based medical device maker.
This modest building in Dublin may be Medtronic's global headquarters, but the company employs around 4,000 people in Ireland, compared to more than 43,000 in the United States.
They went out of their way to guarantee that they weren't going to move employees out of Minnesota, that everything from a U.S. perspective would remain exactly as it was before.
Medtronic declined Newshour Weekend's request to be interviewed. In a written statement, the company said the Covidien acquisition was driven by a strategic decision to combine the companies and become the world's premier medical technology and services company. The deal allows us to accelerate our three core strategies, therapy innovation, globalization, and economic value.
We don't offer any sweetheart tax deals to any individual companies.
Ireland's Minister of Foreign Affairs and Trade, Charlie Flanagan, makes no apologies that 12 of the 20 biggest companies in Ireland have roots in the United States. He says multinational companies have brought hundreds of thousands of jobs to his country and pay their fair share of Irish taxes.
We will continue with a very attractive rate of corporation tax, but we also offer something that perhaps mightn't be as evident in the United States, and that is a very skilled and adaptable workforce.
Veronique DeRuggi is a senior fellow with the Mercatus Center at George Mason University, a conservative think tank partially funded by the Koch brothers. She says corporate taxes ultimately fall on workers.
Economics 101, we know now that the person writing the check is not necessarily the one shouldering the burden of the tax. 70% of the burden of the corporate income tax falls on workers in the form of lower wages.
Our objective is to make U.S. businesses the most competitive in the world.
When the Trump administration unveiled its one-page outline for rewriting the tax code this week, it featured a cut in the corporate tax rate from 35 to 15%. The White House also wants a one-time tax holiday that would allow American companies to repatriate that $2.6 trillion in overseas cash at a reduced, though as yet unspecified, rate.
Which will bring back trillions of dollars that are offshore to be invested here in the United States to purchase capital and to create jobs.
In addition, the White House wants to stop taxing profits earned overseas. That's also a staple of the tax reform blueprint by House Speaker Paul Ryan and House Ways and Means Committee Chairman Kevin Brady. The Ryan-Brady plan would cut the corporate tax rate to 20%, not 15%, and would introduce a new tax on imports to offset the revenue loss. Republican Illinois Congressman Peter Roskam chairs the House Ways and Means Subcommittee on Tax Policy.
Tax cuts have to pay for themselves. Our argument is this will create growth, and that pays for itself.
The proposed new tax is called a border adjustment tax, a 20% levy on imports, which Roskam says will encourage companies to produce more in the U.S. and keep profits here.
Right now, if you're a manufacturer in the Chicago area, if you're in my constituency and you're making a product, the cost of your product includes the income tax that the company pays for that. Then when it's exported and it goes into another jurisdiction, it goes to, let's say, Germany, for example. The Germans move that in and they tax it as well. Our weakness here is that the inverse is not true. So if you're a German manufacturer and you're making something in Stuttgart, Germany, when it comes to the United States, we don't tax it. So literally, our products are double taxed. Theirs are not taxed.
The CEOs of 16 American exporting giants, which underpin millions of American jobs, including Boeing and Caterpillar, agree. In a letter to Congress, they said the border adjustment tax is a critical element of tax reform that ensures goods and services produced abroad face the same tax burden as those produced in the United States. But more than 100 American companies and trade groups that rely on cheap imports, including retailer Walmart, which alone employs 1.5 million Americans, oppose a border adjustment tax. They say it would increase their costs, leaving them little choice but to raise prices for consumers. But Congressman Roskam says that's unlikely because a border adjustment tax will increase the value of the dollar and effectively lower the cost of imports.
As these border adjustment moves in, the dollar gets stronger, the price of imports gets lower, and we can make transition rules that are reasonable for companies.
Many economists, including Veronique DeRuggi, question whether the dollar would rise sufficiently.
The idea that the dollar will adjust not only perfectly and completely to the border adjustment tax, but also quickly, is an article of faith.
In February, President Trump said a border adjustment tax could lead to a lot more jobs in the United States. But this week, Treasury Secretary Steven Mnuchin said the White House does not support it in its current form. The White House says its corporate tax cuts will pay for themselves through higher economic growth. But with many economists warning that the plan could add trillions to the federal budget deficit, there are serious differences to bridge to parlay frustration with the corporate tax code into fundamental change.
We can't stay here. This current tax code is a failure. There is a massive amount of money, and whether it's $1 trillion, $2 trillion, $3 trillion, or $4 trillion, it's too much money that's stuck overseas, and we need to create an environment where that money can come back.